on the dot, and we are about to kick off today's Pepperdine Career Week conversation, which is on entrepreneurship, drawing your own career map. I am Hilary Rushford, coming to you live from Home Sweet Brooklyn. And we are going to hold for about 5 minutes while we let everyone gather live. So there's some of you that are joining us via your own personal web computers. And then there's also a group that's gathering live to watch together in a classroom in Malibu. So we're going to get started at about 2:05. So if you are watching on your work computer, feel free to mute me and tune out until 2:05 if you would like to come back and join us. But in the meantime, for those of you who are here on your own personal computers, you guys can use the questions box. And if you'll just let me know that you can hear and see me, that would be awesome and super helpful. You should be able to see my lovely little PowerPoint presentation here and my little picture down on the right-hand side. So you know there's a real person on the other side of this voice. Awesome. Thank you, Melanie, says she can see and hear me. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Rachel. Awesome. Okay, perfect. So for those of you, hi, Novita. I love seeing these names that I know. So while we're hanging out, if anyone has any questions that they feel like leading with while we're sitting here for 5 minutes, you're welcome to throw those in the questions box, but there absolutely will be time for Q&A at the end. So now we're just going to practice that art of listening where you just sit in comfortable silence for 2 minutes with strangers and everyone's okay with it. Hi, Mom. Hi, sister. For those of you who are just now joining us, no one panic. We're going to get started at 2:05 so that everyone who's watching live in a classroom has time to gather together. So hold tight for a few minutes, and then the lovely Amy Hunter Adams is going to do a little introduction for us. And Amy, I will unmute you in just a minute here. My sister was like, can you see us? How did you know I was here? And my mom said the same thing. Are you seeing me? Are you seeing this? So I have a list of names for those of you who are joining live or joining on your personal computers. So you registered with your name. So that's how I'm able to see people that I know who are on the call, including my mother and my sister and friends that I went to see her undergrad with. But no, I can't actually see your faces. So don't worry if you need to like eat your lunch while we're doing this. I'm not going to be able to see if you have, you know, food in your teeth. My sister said, thank goodness, because I have no makeup on. I'm in my bathrobe. Sorry for outing you, Ashley. She has a little baby. It's, you know, it's fine. Okay, so Amy, I'm going to go ahead and unmute you and just make sure that everything's working there. Amy, do you want to say hi at some point and unmute?
Good morning / afternoon, depending on what time zone you're calling in from. This is Amy Adams. I'm the director of the Seaver College Career Center, and we're gearing up for another great Career Week event with Hilary.
Wow. So are you ready to get started, Amy, or do you want to wait another minute?
Let's go ahead and dive in. Just in the interest of time, we want to make the most of having you join us. So I will just do a couple introductory remarks, and then we'll turn it over to Hilary. This week is Pepperdine Career Week. It's our sixth annual Career Week, and there are 25 events happening across all of our Pepperdine campuses. This is a collaboration between all five of our Pepperdine schools, so our undergraduate college at Seaver College, as well as our four graduate schools. And so it's exciting to be able to provide programming and events for all of our different types of students and alumni across Pepperdine, and to collaborate in that effort. And of course, one of our favorite things to do is to bring back and to feature our alumni and to leverage their expertise in the various fields and industries that they are succeeding in most cases. And so we are thrilled today to be joined by Hilary Rushford. She is in Brooklyn in New York, and has set aside time from her busy schedule to be with us, to impart her wisdom and experience to us. And we're so excited to hear from her today. Just a couple of quick housekeeping notes. There are lots of other events happening this week. So whether you can participate online or come out in person, we'd invite you to do so. There are calendars outside if you're here in person. There's registration site online, pepperdine.edu/careerweek, if you're interested in attending other events. The SoCal Social is happening tonight at the Lux Sunset Boulevard Hotel in Brentwood, and that's going to be a great offsite networking event for people to connect at. So if you are in town and able to participate, we'd encourage you to come out. Registration, pre-registration is closed, but you can show up and be a walk-in at the door. So that starts at 6 o'clock tonight in West LA Brentwood. If you have questions, definitely let us know. The other thing I'd just like to mention briefly is that if you find yourself learning something valuable in this session, and we hope that you do, we encourage you to tweet or kind of post on Instagram or Facebook or any form of social media using hashtag Career Week to share with us what you've learned. So we're just trying to aggregate feedback from all of our events during the week, and would encourage you after the session today to maybe mention one or two takeaways that you experienced during the session. So without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Hilary Rushford. She's an alumna of Pepperdine, class of 2002. We enjoyed our freshman seminar together here at Pepperdine. I think that was our first point of connection, and have had lots of other things that we've been able to participate in over the years. So Hilary will do a further introduction of herself and tell her story, but welcome Hilary.
Thank you, Amy. And thank you guys so much for being here, whether you're live there in Malibu together or the group that is joining us from your individual computers that are logged on separately here via chat. So to answer a quick question that Blanche typed into the question box, which is the target audience current students or alumni? It's definitely both. Most of my business coaching clients are probably in their late 20s through their late 30s, but I definitely think entrepreneurship applies to truly teens all the way on up. So I think everything we're covering today will apply regardless of where you're at as far as age spectrum or where you're at in your journey or exploration of entrepreneurship. So today's title is Entrepreneurship, Drawing Your Own Career Map. And I am Hilary Rushford of Dean Street Society, coming to you live from Home Sweet Brooklyn, where it is a winter wonderland of snow outside. So I trust that it is a different kind of lovely out there in Malibu, from what I recall. So by quick way of hello introductions here, just want to let you guys know that after today's seminar, if you want to chime in more and continue this conversation, if you want more advice and information, definitely head to deanstreetsociety.com/HS. That stands for Honor Society, which is my mailing list. And if you hop on the entrepreneur list, that's definitely the best place to continue to engage in this conversation. Here's also how you can find me on Instagram and Twitter. Instagram is definitely where I hang out the most. So if you kind of want to keep getting to know each other and getting insights on business, that's definitely where I share it. You can use those when you're using the hashtag Career Week, like Amy said. And then afterwards, there's going to be a recording of this going up next week at the Pepperdine Career Center website. So if you think of a friend after this, or you're chatting with someone in the next week who's like, oh man, I wish I'd heard that class, send them there. We'll get them a recording. So quick little background on why someone might think that I'm qualified to speak at Career Week. So my company is called Dean Street Society, and a few of my notable accomplishments where I brag for 5 seconds so that you are interested in listening to me for the next hour are in the last 2.5 years since I started my business. I've hosted a show on the Hello Style channel for Hearst Media. I was featured in the September issues of Better Homes and Gardens and Verily Magazine. I've spoken at Alt Summit, Independent Fashion Bloggers, and Pepperology, some of the big events in the blogger world. I made my business profitable in under 2 years, and I have style and business coaching clients worldwide from Tokyo, Canada, Singapore, Germany, Edinburgh, and more, thanks to the lovely power of Skype and Google Hangouts. So my college season, as Amy said, I graduated from Sieber College with a major in English and theater. I was a DG, I was the president of Dance on Flight, studied in Heidelberg, choreographed and directed the Songfest host, and served on Pepperdine Ambassadors Council with Amy and Rachel, both of whom are in the Career Center now, which is awesome. But just as an insight for what was happening for me when I was in college, I think I had about 12 majors. Is there anyone else who can relate? You can type yes into the chat box, of changing your major a lot of times. I was always theater and something else, but I didn't know I could actually make a career of theater. Rachel says truth. So this, by the way, is a photo of me performing at Lyndhurst Theater, also known as the only photo I have on my Facebook profile from college years. Clearly, I was in a pre-Facebook era. So I changed my major a bunch of times. I was always theater and something else, but I didn't really think at all that I could make a career out of theater. So I was always trying to figure out what in the world it was that I actually wanted to do. And I remembered just very recently this balance between this thought that I had in college that I really wanted to be on stage and perform and pursue theater and be creative. And I also really wanted to wear pencil skirts and high heels and have a corner office somewhere. I definitely had this right and left brain duality, which I didn't realize at the time. No one helped me articulate that. I don't know, again, show of hands in person or yes in the question box here, if you can empathize with, I really had that creative side and I really had that business side. And there was part of me that wanted to like be working in some big fancy office. And there was part of me that wanted like freedom and autonomy and creativity. Andrea says yes. Novita says absolutely. So in hindsight, I think I was perfectly wired to be an entrepreneur, but that was not really a word that anyone was talking about. We had no major, minor, any sort of conversation happening around entrepreneurship. So once I did come onto this idea, which was just exactly 3 years ago, actually, February 1st was my aha moment. This is what I was meant to do with my life. It really clicked. Oh yeah, back when I was going to Pepperdine, I was really torn, feeling like I had to pick one side of my brain. And that's part of the reason why I struggled so much with majors. So anyways, I did actually have a career in theater, despite not thinking that that was going to be a valid career path. So I ended up getting cast on a Broadway tour 1 month after I graduated. I toured with 42nd Street, then the Radio City Rockettes. I did lots of catering in between because no matter how successful you are, there are lots of crap day jobs in the middle, which later informed my quest for entrepreneurship. And then I thought that I was always going to head to graduate school, get my MFA in acting and teach at a university like Pepperdine. But I fell in love with Brooklyn and did not want to leave and start my life over. And I think that's just an interesting note, specifically for those of you who are still in undergrad right now, that sort of the best laid plans. I mean, I had that plan for a decade. I was sure that that is, well, not quite a decade, but I was sure that that was always what I was going to do when I left New York. And sometimes there's twists and turns in life. And it wasn't that I didn't desire the career anymore of teaching or working in a university, but there was something in my life now that I desired actually more than that career, which was the community that I'm a part of here in Brooklyn, just the life that I lead, the people I'm surrounded by. And there really wasn't a graduate school or a university that were of the style I would want to be a part of that were here in Brooklyn. I never saw myself teaching at a NYU with kids who moved to Manhattan at 18. I always thought I would teach at more of a liberal arts school like Pepperdine, but I realized that meant having to move. So again, just an encouragement in case 7 years from now, you have a crisis of what you want to be when you grow up and you think, oh yeah, I remember hearing this girl, Hilary, talk one time and saying, I was really confident what my career was. And then my life changed. I got married. I had a baby. I realized I didn't want to move. Something happened with my health. And suddenly there was something I actually wanted more that was motivating me more than this career desire. And therefore, I had to be open, in my case, to a whole new idea of what I wanted to be when I grew up. And I actually literally emailed a handful of my friends with an email entitled, prayer for what the hell I'm doing with my life. And I was like, I think I need a new thing to be when I grow up. So I am taking suggestions and recommendations if anyone would like to throw something in the hat. And most of my girlfriends wrote back something having to do with styling. And very long story, very short, we were kind of off to the races and running. So I started out as a personal stylist. I launched in September 2011, so almost 2.5 years ago. And my company is called Dean Street Society. I live on Dean Street here in Brooklyn, and I was striving to create a brand that was very inclusive in an industry that traditionally is very exclusive. This is very much like trends and hot and not and what's in and what's out and what designer you're wearing and whether or not you have enough money and you look cool enough. And I really wanted instead to create a community space where you're welcome at any kind of style, any kind of budget, any kind of body type, any sort of level of where you're at. You can be a part of Dean Street Society. This is my virtual home. You're welcome in. Have a cup of tea, have a glass of wine, kick your shoes off, and let's talk about the real things of life. So I'm a personal stylist for what I call real people with real budgets. So I take my clients shopping at Forever 21 and J.Crew. And I'm a solopreneur as opposed to the sort of the only idea I really had of entrepreneurship when I was an undergrad was like venture capital. You know, you're getting $1 million in funds from angel investors, and you have shareholders, and like, you know, this whole other world that was very like MBA business heavy. That was not my background. I know some people from the Pepperdine Alumni Association had come to town a couple, maybe 2 years ago now, taken me and some other alumni students to lunch, which is so sweet. And they were really trying to figure out how they could help tie someone like me into the alumni organization. And they really kept pushing like meeting up with the MBA grads and things like that. And I was really trying to explain that's kind of a whole different ballgame. We might both call ourselves entrepreneurs, but someone who went through an MBA program and is going through fellow alumni there trying to get people to invest, you know, thousands and millions of startup capital in their business is a whole different industry than what I am, which is called in some ways the $100 startup or like starting a business from your kitchen table. You literally just need a website and you can launch. So that's the kind of business I have as a solopreneur and definitely where my area of expertise is, since that's my personal example. And as I said, in my case, my friends made me do it. And so also that bit of insight is just in saying that if you have these desires that you feel like some people come to entrepreneurship because they have an idea and then they realize, oh, chasing that idea would be being an entrepreneur. Other people come to it saying, I really want to be an entrepreneur. What's an idea that I could come up with? Both are perfectly valid ways to come about it. But mine was my friends giving me the idea, then me realizing that would be being an entrepreneur. And then furthermore, really realizing that entrepreneurship was what I was passionate about. It wasn't fashion. It wasn't that world, but styling was a natural gift and tool that I could offer and I could monetize so that I could build a lifestyle of entrepreneurship. So that was my background. Then I transitioned into or expanded into a mentoring season. So after about a year or so of running my business, I just realized I was getting emails all the time. My most common email is, what advice do you have for starting a business? And I just couldn't keep up with the influx of emails. I really wanted to be helpful, but I like to say that being an entrepreneur is like being a single parent of triplets. You're tired all the time. Something is always crying. You need more arms. You need two brains. You like lose your glasses when they're sitting on top of your head. But you're like have this glow about you because you're creating this new life and it's just like all you can eat, sleep, breathe, think about. So you're sort of like insane and like marvelously happy all at the same time. So when you're insane, if you can picture being a single parent of triplets, you don't freaking have time to be replying to emails, but you're getting all these people asking for help. So that's really why I started expanding into one-on-one coaching. And that is what led to writing a book, which launched in December, which is called The Four-Part Entrepreneur Cocktail, which is mostly what we're going to talk about today. So here's what I don't teach, which is how to run a business. And this is not what we're going to cover today, but all the types of information that are out there that you need to learn about in the beginning: marketing, pricing, sales cycles, copywriting, social media, publicity, your ideal client, collaborating, scalability, branding, technology, hiring. This is all stuff that I have studied over the last couple years. And on my last slides, I've got some great names and books that I would recommend that you go and study for that. So for me, I feel like there are brilliant people out there teaching how to run a business, and that wasn't what my clients needed. They might be asking those questions, but I knew who to direct them to. So for me, that wasn't a gap in the market, which is another thing when you're starting a business is, what can I offer that someone isn't already offering, or I can offer better? So in styling services, I felt that I could offer it better or differently than what was out there. And in what I do with business coaching, I felt like or specifically with writing my book, I felt like I was talking about things that I didn't hear other people talking about that were pain points for my clients. I heard them struggling with and not really having the tools and the resources. And there we go. So my main question is, how do you know that entrepreneurship will lead to success and happiness for you? And this was really what I found that my clients weren't asking. I said, are we just buying into what's cool? And this has been my fear with entrepreneurship, that it's so trendy right now that it just seems like what everyone's doing. It seems like what all the cool kids are doing. And so it's very enticing. And you get really drawn into it without actually knowing if it actually is going to make you happy and if it actually is something that you personally could succeed at. So part of my theory of this comes from the fact that there are books out there like Escape from Cubicle Nation. And there's just a lot of push right now about this concept that, you know, if you're reading this book, it makes it seem like if you're not escaping from Cubicle Nation, there's something wrong with you. You're missing the boat. Obviously, everyone should be escaping from Cubicle Nation. But I think that the challenge of that is that most of the people who are writing these books and, you know, talking on these topics, their only demographic, their only clientele are fellow entrepreneurs. So without it being disingenuous, they have a desire and a benefit if more of you become entrepreneurs because you're going to buy their books and, you know, buy their products. I felt like I had a unique place in that half of my clients are in styling and half of my clients are in business. So I feel like I can be really honest that business is not for everyone and you still might have something else that you can buy for me. So my ability to pay my rent is not based solely on whether or not I can convince you to pursue and stick with entrepreneurship. So I feel like that has allowed me to be more honest than some of my colleagues who, again, are not being inauthentic. But I feel like I can be more honest about the parts of it that are really hard. So I just fear, are we buying into a story of spin and branding? And again, understanding where that comes from, why these authors and speakers are motivated to say this. So what I say in my book is entrepreneurship isn't winning. Your happiness is winning. Let's just find out what makes you happy. And so that's a lot of my desire to plant some seeds for you today, and a lot of my desire in the book is making sure that this is actually a path of happiness, and far better for you to sit and listen to a 1-hour class during career week and take a look at a book and find out actually this isn't going to make you happy, or yes, it is, and therefore the hard work of the crying triplets is totally going to be worth it because this is my best life and my best pursuit of happiness. So when I got all of those emails asking me what my advice was, I had a lot of guilt in some ways because I felt like there were certain things that made entrepreneurship easier for me than the average person. And it was kind of hard to articulate and write down. I just felt like I couldn't necessarily say it was just this or just that because I thought, well, this was going in my favor, or I naturally had this tendency. So what I did is I sat down and I read through the first 2 years of my journal. And out of that came these four repeating themes that ended up becoming my book, which, like I said, is titled The Four-Part Entrepreneur Cocktail. So here's the four parts of the cocktail, which to me are about finding your two building a business that truly makes you happy and is truly profitable. So my tagline is, it pays your rent without checking you into the hospital for exhaustion. So part one is what motivates you. Part two, your DNA and talents. Part three, saying yes to profits. And part four, saying no to overwhelm. So these are the four parts that we're going to walk through today. And as I said, for me, this is a recipe that's half happiness, parts one and two, and half success, parts three and four. So part one on what motivates you is, how do you want to feel? And that might sound like a little bit of a woo-woo question, or if, you know, for the men that are listening, that might sound like a bit of a feminine question. But there's one of my entrepreneur mentors whose name is Danielle Laporte. She's on the last slide, so you can copy that down. She talks about something called core desired feelings. And the idea is this. For example, I had a friend who was working in a menswear company as an art director. He also had previously freelanced as an art director, and he was trying to decide whether or not he wanted to leave this fancy job where he wasn't really happy and go back to freelance, which has its own challenges. And so we talked through, how is it that you really want to feel? And so two of his core desired feelings were to feel powerful and strong. So, and I said to him, so Nate, if you really want to feel powerful, does it make you feel more powerful to put on your swanky suit, get on the subway in the morning, get into your office, have the fancy business cards, pick up the phone, have the nice computer, all of that? Or does it make you feel more powerful to be in sweatpants, sitting on your couch with your laptop? Because both of those stories could be equally successful and could be equally as have equal happiness for two different people. And someone is going to feel like they're part of the rat race having to put on the suit, and somebody else is going to feel really just kind of underwhelmed and lame that they're sitting in their sweatpants every day. While someone else is going to feel totally badass that they're in the swanky suit, or they don't even have to leave their apartment on a snow day like this. So for me, two of my core desired feelings are empowered and wise. And that this just really was an aha moment for me, because it allowed me to look back at my last career of theater and realize, as much as I loved that career, as much as I was successful at that career, there were certain parts of how I really want to feel that weren't present there, or weren't present there all the time. So in theater, you're very not empowered. It does not matter how hard you work, how hard you train, how much preparation, you can walk into your room and just not be what they're looking for. Or you can walk into your room and they have some specific thing they need for that part, like a backflip that you can't do. So no matter how hard you work, you're always at the whim of someone else. I feel much more empowered in my business on a daily basis. I feel like if I need more income, I can take action to do that. I feel, you know, I'm in control of my days. I can decide what I want to work on. That for me, as hard as the work is, I feel so empowered. And that is such a motivating feeling for me, that one of the big questions I get is, how do you stay motivated? For me, it's pick a career that makes you feel the way you want to feel. And because entrepreneurship makes me feel empowered, I'm motivated to get out of bed every day and get to work. It isn't hard for me to pull myself out of bed. In between theater and founding my business, I took a day job in the human resources and payroll department of a large real estate company. I refer to it as the place where dreams go to die. I was miserable, and it was so hard to get out of bed in the morning because nothing about that job made me feel the way I want to feel. One of my other core desired feelings is wise, and that's something that, again, you don't get to use a lot of that left brain business part of you in the theater industry. And in this case, I really get to use this business prowess that I kind of always felt like I had, but it never said so on my resume. It, like, my degree isn't in that. None of my jobs were in that. And now I really get to tap into teaching and creating and giving business advice. And I feel more wise than I felt in my old career. As I said with the analogy of my friend Nate, there's no better or worse feelings, and there's no better or worse decisions. It's all about just being motivated to feel the way we want to feel. And I think that's a really powerful question to ask whatever career you're pursuing, is, what do I really want to feel? What does happiness and success feel like to me? And is this career versus this other option going to give it to me? Part two of the cocktail for me is your talents and your DNA. So first of all, what comes naturally to you? This was the part that I felt a little guilty when I was trying to reply to these emails sometimes, because I felt like I had natural things that were already going for me out of the gate when I started as an entrepreneur. One, I was an English major, so writing comes easily to me. I have a lot of clients that really struggle with writer's block in their blog posts, in their newsletters. They're not really great at writing copy. I always get asked who writes the copy on my website. I do. That's something else that people really struggle with or have to export. Two, I was a theater major. So whenever I do on camera things, when I do photo shoots, all of that again comes so naturally. There's lots of entrepreneurs. They hate having their photo taken. They know everyone's doing video, but they're so uncomfortable on camera. I was a choreographer. So I love teaching, and that naturally is what I do. I have a lot of friends and clients actually who've started businesses. Again, they really wanted to be an entrepreneur, but they haven't quite figured out what they should be an entrepreneur in. And so they're trying to teach something and then finding out they actually don't like teaching and they aren't really a great teacher. Maybe they actually do have that skill set, but if you're hiring someone for one-on-one coaching or small group coaching, or you're putting out some sort of e-course, you have to be a teacher. That was just a skill I naturally had been choreographing since I was literally in junior high, and it came second nature to me. And also my background as an actor, uncertainty, having to hustle, understanding your brand and branding and marketing, those were all things I'd been doing in my last business that carried over. So the idea to me of not having health insurance and a steady paycheck is the story of my adult life. I've never had regular health insurance and a steady paycheck. So for someone leaving a corporate job and heading into that uncertainty, that feels a lot more challenging than it did for me. The other thing is, this is a breakdown, a graphic from inside my book. And you'll see on the side here, it says nature and nurture. And the idea is, here is a, whoops, sorry. Okay, so here's what I wrote out. This is, again, a graphic from my book that I compared musical theater and entrepreneurship and went through saying, what are my strengths in all of these different areas and what are my gaps? And I think that, again, when you're trying to decide what your career paths are, you know, you're trying to decide between two career paths, you're trying to decide if entrepreneurship is right for you, or even just two paths within entrepreneurship. Maybe you have two business ideas, or you have two paths you want to take this business down, but you're not sure which one to go down first. A lot of my secret to success was that Rachel and Amy are saying they just lost our audio. So hang tight. Let me see. Okay. And Rachel says we're back. Perfect. Okay. So for me, this chart is kind of about saying one of the secrets of my success was feeling like I actually was really naturally cut out to be an entrepreneur. It really naturally plays to a lot of my strengths. If you run down this list, writing, learning, teaching, aesthetics, creative, hustler, passionate, the type who'd be the president of something, analytical, organized, business-minded. So it just played to a lot of my natural strengths in areas that, because I was working and coaching one-on-one, I was able to become aware that not everyone had these strengths. And I just kind of had a leg up and was a little bit better prepared out of the gate, which does not mean that if you're not prepared coming out of the gate, you can't grow in those ways. But it definitely explains why certain things were easier for me or happened more quickly than they do for other people. The other element of this part two in DNA and talents is, what's your personality? So in my case, I did not know that I was such an introvert. I spend 80% of my time working alone. And even in a setting like this, I mean, you know, there's people online, there's people live, there's a bunch of people listening to this class. But in reality, I'm sitting alone in my home office, like in my slippers. I can't see any of you. I'm not really, you know, vibing off of your energy like if I was there live. I actually love that. I don't mind teaching this way at all. I love sitting in coffee shops by myself working. I have other friends and clients who are miserable with that. They feel so lonely. They feel so disconnected, so detached. I have friends that try and teach like this online and they just think it's so awkward because they're not getting any feedback. On the other hand, I also am still an extrovert. So I don't have the challenge that some of my friends and clients do, going to conferences, doing on camera, getting up and speaking or teaching when I am live. And I think the real important question to pay attention to here is looking at who your business models and mentors are, first of all, and finding people who have a similar personality type to you, because there are successful people with all sorts of personality types. Again, it's not about being better or worse, but when you're looking at the people that you want to model yourselves after, really pay attention to what are their strengths and DNA? What are the things that they naturally are working off of? And if you are modeling yourself after someone who has written a ton of books and writing is not one of your strengths, maybe that's someone that you can learn from and be inspired by, but maybe their business model and their profit streams are not exactly what you want to follow. So I think a mistake a lot of people make is just by saying, I think, you know, Richard Branson is awesome, or Seth Godin, or whoever it is, Tim Ferriss. And their profit streams, their business model, the way they're making money, what they're getting paid for, whether they're speaking, teaching, writing, extrovert, introvert, you know, emotional, analytical, really pay attention to finding people whose strengths align with yours and make sure that you're building a business model and profit streams that play well to that. Because again, I have a lot of people that I see where they think writing a book is going to be the secret to success because they're following in someone else's footsteps and they loathe writing. In my case, I loved writing. I just like could sit down and write all day. I did not know that about myself until I tried, but it turned out that I loved writing. I love teaching. I love speaking. All of those things are things that other friends and clients of mine don't love and sometimes have gotten themselves into feeling like a failure or feeling trapped or just really struggling with motivation because they weren't putting two and two together, that just because it works for someone else doesn't mean it's the best path for you if you have a different personality, different strengths, and DNA. So part three of the cocktail is saying yes to profits, which might sound kind of like a simple concept, but the idea, it's a lot more challenging than it seems to focus on this one element of needing to stay profitable in order to keep moving. So my question for myself and my clients is always, how do you pay X by X? Because this equation changes for everyone. For me, this has always been, how do I pay my rent in the next 30 days? So I started off not having a huge savings account, not having a huge trust fund. So I didn't have all the time in the world to make this business profitable. If I didn't make it profitable by a certain point, I was gonna have to take 50% of my time away and go get a part-time job. And because I knew in theory, I could make more money working for myself than I could at a part-time job, I really was motivated to figure out how do I make this profitable so I can give it 100% of my time. But for some people, that's paying off their student loans in the next 2 years. Some people are starting entrepreneurship as a side job that allows them to set aside a vacation fund to take an incredible trip once a year. So this is very personal, but it really is about focusing on the profitability, which is so challenging because there's so many other components that you have to deal with as an entrepreneur. For example, your growth, focusing on getting more of an audience, getting more traffic to your website, all of your social media channels, getting more publicity, just keeping up with 4 social media profiles and a blog and trying to guest post and reply to interview requests, trying to pitch all of those, that in and of itself would absolutely be a full-time job if that's all I allowed myself to focus on. The second is your foundation, your finances, legal, website, whether that's like the tech part of building the website, maintaining it. You know, right now we're having to figure out 1099s for all of my freelancers. I've never figured out 1099s before. I'm having to figure out like, how do I comply with laws? I had to get a DBA, all of these things that I'm exploring for the first time. I have a bookkeeper. So all of that as well, there's so many more things we could be doing that could be a full-time job if I allowed myself to prioritize that. And then there's creation, coming up with new offerings. How do you turn your current customers into repeat customers by creating new things? How do you expand and find a new market by creating things, you know, for people who are not yet your customers. So there's so many different things that are pulling at you that it's easier said than done to put your blinders on and say, how am I going to pay X by X? How am I going to pay my rent next month? What's the smartest decisions I can make this week that are going to help me pay my rent by next month, my student loans off in the next 2 years, et cetera. And it really is about asking yourself what's most important, which I like to use the phrase a lot. I care more about being profitable than popular. I care more about profitability than popularity, which sounds like, okay, sure, you know, that's how we all feel. But actually, it is such a slippery slope to not care about new Instagram followers, new traffic to the website, you know, new Facebook likes. You're paying attention to all those markers, and they can translate into profitability. They can translate into new customers. So it's not unwise to be paying attention, but it is so much easier to say, if I go to all these events during Fashion Week, I'm going to look really cool and swanky. I'm going to get a lot of likes on Instagram. I might get new followers because I'm hanging out with other popular bloggers. But is that really going to lead to profitability? Because I don't have a whole lot of products that an 18-year-old high school student is going to come and buy from me. So you might like style blogs, but just because you come and like me on Instagram from another blogger doesn't actually help me to pay my rent, but it might make me feel cool for a night to have all of these new likes and comments happening. So I have to be like, I'm going to stay home in my yoga pants and work on a new offering that we're launching next Thursday instead of going to this fashion show tonight. True story. And it's also saying, is this important to me that this is a business instead of a hobby? And I said, if there was a guaranteed path to fiscal success, everyone would succeed, but most fail. So I think that's why this seems like it's a really obvious concept, but it's something that most people are not able to figure out. And I think that it takes both courage and wisdom. Courage because there is not a clear path. Like we said, if there was a guaranteed path, everyone would do it. So it takes a lot of leaping, a lot of blind faith, a lot of trying things you don't know if they're going to work. And it also takes a lot of wisdom because I have a handful of friends and clients that have had a lot of courage to go out there, and they are $80,000 in debt because they have not had a lot of wisdom along the way to say, okay, this isn't paying off yet. Let me press pause on this, go find another source of income, take a day job for 6 months, get myself back on track. And so they just ran ahead with such courage that they're in debt at this point because they didn't have the wisdom. I also have a lot of really smart clients that are so analytical and so in their heads. They're trying to be so wise. They're not having any courage because they aren't willing to leap unless they've absolutely figured it out. But like I said, if there was a guaranteed path, everyone would be doing it. The answer is the sweet spot in between that courage and wisdom. So the fourth part of the cocktail here, and then I'm going to open this up to questions. If you are live in Malibu with Amy, she is unmuted and you actually can head up to her computer, or she can direct you. So if you can hop on the call and we can hear your question, or if you are joining us on the computer, you can type it into the question box. So the final part of the cocktail, part four, is how do you not burn out? And this is, you know, parts one and two really were about how do you make sure this is going to make you happy before you even start? And that's just a question I don't think enough people are asking. Part three is how do you make this profitable, which is a question I get a lot because, as I said on the last slide, a lot of people can't do it and really struggle with it. So it really takes a lot of focus to be savvy about that. But then the fourth part that I hear about all the time. I just taught a class at the biggest blogger conference last week on this called Overcoming Overwhelm, is the sense that you are the single parent of triplets. There is so freaking much to do. How do you get through the day, and how do you make that sustainable as you get through the months and the years and it keeps on coming? So the challenge really is because out of 700, you have 748 to-dos and a team of one. And you know, most everyone who is in an office setting, you have things that you delegate, you have team members that you share things with. When you're an entrepreneur, you do everything yourself. I spoke to a group of junior high girls one time. And I said, tell me something that one of your parents or your siblings do. And it was career week for them. And they were bringing in, you know, it was like my friend Luke, who's an FBI agent, and my friend Jess, who like works with Alicia Keys. And so to these girls, everyone was who was coming in was like super fancy. So this girl was like, well, my dad works at the library and my mom is pretty lame too. She works at the dollar store. Okay, I'm sure neither of your parents are lame, but I said, okay, the dollar store, that's a great example. Let's think of all the jobs that it takes to do a dollar store. So I had the girls listing out, you know, you got to stock the shelves, you got to check out, you got to unpack the boxes at night, you got to handle customer service, everything. And I said, all of those jobs I have to do by myself. And they were like, whoa. So I'm sure your world is not as rocked by as it was by the 12-year-olds. But just that general concept that everything that has to be done by you, of course, would already naturally lead to overwhelm. But then the other challenge is what I call the creative candy shop. And this is why it is so hard to say no, because the yeses, the things we want to say yes to, are all delicious, marvelous, wonderful gems of goodness and good things. And so, yes, you want to do that collaboration and that guest post and write a book and start a YouTube channel and speak at that event and go to that event and grow your Facebook following and do Facebook advertising. And every single one of those things is good. It's candy. It's awesome. It's delicious. But like any child, if we just eat all the candy in the candy store, we're going to be sick to our stomach. We're going to go into sugar shock. We're going to, you know, go really high on adrenaline and then just totally crash. We're going to feel like crap. Our, like, you know, adrenals are going to be zapped. There's just no way to be a healthy, high-functioning person who only eats candy, aside from, despite what Will Ferrell taught us all in Elf. So there is this maturity that has to be in place to say no to things. And it sounds, especially, you know, this is, so, you know, I'm talking to some undergraduate students. I feel like maturity, you know, is a buzzword of like, oh yeah, I'll get there in a few years. But actually all of my mentors that I looked up to, people with billion-dollar businesses, people with their own reality shows, everyone I looked up to when I started has not mastered this. They can't say no to the appearance on Ellen and on The Tonight Show and the cover of the magazine and the cameo in that and the DVD and the new product and this new line and this new business venture. So it isn't just a matter of like age or intelligence. I find that this is something deeply, deeply challenging for creative, ambitious, passionate, talented people, that it's almost like the more you have all of that going for you, the harder it is to have to say no, because the opportunities all get juicier. They all get better. And you have to be like, I can only say no to two things this week. What else are all the other things that I'm saying no to? And so my greatest tool for helping people with this concept of overwhelm, and this applies just throughout anywhere in your life, is a concept that I call the path. And this is a download from my book, where in my case, with entrepreneurship, I encourage people to look ahead 6 to 9 months at where you want to head and then work your way backwards on that path to figure out what do you need to do before that, before that, before that, and be able to clear the clutter on the sides of everything that doesn't apply on there. So one really quick example for sake of time and brevity is I was a theater major. I love doing on-camera work, but a YouTube channel or an on-camera show is never going to be the answer for what's going to pay my rent in the next 30 days. So while that is my question, that has not been something on my path, and it's a delicious piece of candy I desperately want to devour, that I've had to say it can't be on the list for the next 6 to 9 months. Therefore, I'm not going to feel guilty about saying no to it, because I know where I'm headed. I know I'm headed to taking my business to the next level of profitability, and all the steps on the path that I'm headed down are going to be in that direction. And I think this is a really helpful tool for a variety of things in your life, of trying to be like, what do I actually need to make happen by graduation? And what are the things that, to be honest, could be pushed off till this summer if I needed to make them happen? So one of my phrases is, you can do and be anything you want, just not all at the same time. And again, like part three of the cocktail, this really comes back to me for this balance between courage and wisdom, having the courage to say, you know, I don't know what the best answer is going to be. I don't know what's going to make me profitable, but I'm just going to have to pick. And the wisdom to say, I've done the path and I know why I'm saying no to the things that I'm saying no to. Just in summation here about entrepreneurship, the negatives, if you decide to pursue a path of entrepreneurship, what are you giving up? Coworkers, being able to pass something on, teamwork, being able to delegate it to somebody else, not having the buck always stop with you. Stability, a steady paycheck, health insurance, savings. There are definitely a lot of fiscal things that would be easier if I had taken on a more traditional path. Being able to work just 9 to 5. I definitely worked evenings and weekends for the first 2.5 years. Separation of work and life doesn't really happen. You're always eat, sleep, breathing this. Sick days. I was in the hospital in January, and that was really challenging for my business when there was no one to, we had to refund a bunch of things because there was no one else to do it. There wasn't just someone else to pick up the slack like in a traditional office. If you were out for the week, someone would handle all of the fires that came in. Being able to niche into your strengths and specialize. I listed out before all those elements of my business that I have to take care of and be over. And so there really is something to saying, you know, if you want to be a photographer, if you went and worked for a company, all you have to do is take photos. You don't have to deal with the bookkeeping and the legal stuff and the marketing and finding new clients and the invoicing. You literally can just show up with your camera and be just a kick-ass photographer and not have to also be a business person. Not being the boss, which again, comes with a lot of those weights. And I think it seems like the cooler, easier path in some ways, but I actually think there is a lot of freedom to being able to like check out at 5 o'clock and be like, well, my boss is gonna have to deal with that fire because I'm not the boss. And also accountability and guidance and mentorship, that I have a lot of friends who work in traditional offices that love what they're learning from their boss and from their colleagues that are ahead of them. And they really are growing and being challenged and having them support them and getting other jobs. I certainly have found that in entrepreneurship, but you have to seek it out a lot more on your own. But there is a new generation of rich, it has been said, which is a richness not of wealth, but a richness of freedom. And that definitely, for me personally, is the choice that I have made. So for me, the positives and what makes the hustle worth it are autonomy over my days, creating my own schedule, having creativity and critical thinking, my right and left brain, active in my life every day, having influence and an impact and being able to be an inspiration to thousands of people, which was not present in my theater life. Freedom to work from anywhere. Travel is a huge motivator for me. And I've worked from England for a month at 2 different times and Santa Barbara or California for a month. Just in the last year, hiring people and their skill sets. I love that I get to pay my graphic designer who wants to do graphic design and a web designer who loves doing web design, and investing in something I believe in. At the end of the day, of course, no matter, you know, how hard the work is, this really is something that I'm passionate about. So I think it's all about that famous quote of where your deep gladness and the world's great hunger meet, that it truly is what's going to bring you happiness, but also prove to be a fiscal success because there's a need for it in the world. So Amy, you can let me know if we have any cues on that side, and then anyone else who wants to type them into the chat box can do so as well.
Any questions here?
And then this is the same screen that was up in the beginning, that if you want to follow up for more advice, if you hop on deanstreetsociety.com/HS, you will start getting my my weekly newsletter where I just share a whole lot more about adventures and entrepreneurship. And again, Instagram is far and away the social platform where I hang out the most and also share the most just about daily life in entrepreneurship.
Hilary, do you have any questions coming in online?
No, I don't. I think we're good. And then as a reminder too, there is gonna be a recording going up next week at the Pepperdine Career Center website. If you have any friends that you can think of that would have loved this, you can send them there. And then I also have a resource page for you guys here if you want to go back and nab this in the recording, or if you are online, you're able to screen grab this, or if you're watching live, you want to like pull out your phone and take a little picture of it. But these are just a handful of people that I've learned from in all different sorts of areas. Some of them are just really broad entrepreneur mentors, and some of them are more niched into a specific area. Chris said, love Danielle Laporte. I definitely love Danielle Laporte. I'm going to hear her speak next Thursday, which I'm very excited about. And one of these are all individuals, but the Influence Network is the only one that isn't. That's a Christian blogger network that specifically, if you're more of the blogging inclined nature, is a really cool resource to check out. And then I also listed out a couple of my favorite books. I'm very reticent to recommend books because, like television shows, I feel like you can end up with like 29 million recommendations and they take a long time to consume. But these are five that I really love: The E-Myth Revisited, Firestarter Sessions. There's a whole suite of books at 99u.com. I have a feeling all of them are brilliant, but I have not. I think maybe they have like four by now. I have not read all of them, but I have friends that have. The $100 Startup and The 4-Hour Workweek. Andrew said, what does your feedback network look like for new ideas? In other words, how do you confirm that your ideas are worth pursuing? That's an awesome idea, or awesome question. Most of my ideas have come out of the questions people have asked. They haven't necessarily written to say, could you offer this product? But for example, I teach a 1-hour seminar on Photoshop basics for blogs and marketing. I mean, in general, I don't give tech advice, but that was just something that, because I have a very visual brand, I'm always putting graphics out there. And in the entrepreneurship groups that I'm a part of on Facebook, which, by the way, is probably like the best part of a lot of programs that are out there, are the private Facebook groups that exist. That's where all of my colleagues are from. All of my friends and mentors are from these Facebook groups of different programs that I've been a part of. So when I would put out my graphics for different things, people were always asking, saying like, oh, I love your graphics. Who does your graphics? Oh, I wish I could do graphics like that. Man, your graphics are always so great. And I just started to realize these other entrepreneurs wish that they could do this themselves. So I literally had the idea at like midnight, threw up a graphic, put it out by 2 a.m. And the next morning, like, the class sold out in a day. And I was like, oh, okay. And that also, Andrew, is an example that in hindsight, I charged $38 for the class. I didn't bother to look at like what other people were charging. In hindsight, I realized that like Influence Conference charges $10 for their classes. Alt Summit charges $15 for their classes. I was charging like 2-3 times what I probably would have if I had done market research to test it, or if I had, AKA if I Google searched to see what else was out there. And because it was like midnight and I wasn't even thinking about it, I just did it. And as a result, made 200 to 300% the profit that I would have if I had researched. In my case, though, I will say, like, I think I have good gut instincts at that kind of stuff, because I have other clients that have put something out there at like $1,000. And I'm thinking, you just don't have a website that backs up the fact that someone should be paying you $1,000 for this. Like, I think you should start out with a lower end thing. So that doesn't always mean just upsell and charge higher. But even when it was the one-on-one coaching, that came out of people just writing and asking for help. And I have a website event that I'm launching next week, because the number one thing I hear from my clients is they feel trapped by their websites, overwhelmed by their websites. They have website shame. It's like too expensive, et cetera, et cetera. So a lot of it's just really listening to what people are asking about. Melanie said, do you think franchises are a good way to get into doing your own thing with a bit of a safety net? Melanie, I really don't have any experience with franchising. I would say that that's more along the other line of the other side of entrepreneurship, that's more on the venture capital side. My expertise really is all on the solopreneur, $100 startup kind of side that doesn't take a lot of money from it. I would honestly, I know this kind of sounds like a cop-out answer, but really so often the best answers are just found by Googling. I'm sure so many people have written blog posts on that, who have yay or nay on either side.